In the previous video we have learned how to compose logic gates of transistors, diodes and resistors. In this video I would like to introduce basic computer circuits using logic gates. Computer-based devices usually use the binary system to process data. The binary numeral system or base 2 numeral system represents numeric values using just two symbols, 0 and 1. In contrast, the decimal system uses 10 symbols. When doing counting, the low order digit, which is the rightmost digit, is incremented by 1. If the low order digit in the decimal system is 9, the next higher order digit, located one position to the left, is incremented and counting in the low order digit starts over at 0. For decimal counting we get the sequence of numbers shown here. Binary counting follows exactly the same rules, except that only two symbols are available, hence after a digit reaches 1 in binary, counting starts over at 0, while the next higher order digit is incremented. Each digit of a binary number represents an increasing power of 2, with the rightmost digit representing 2 raised by the exponent of 0, the next representing 2 raised by the exponent of 1, then 2 raised by the exponent of 2 and so on. The rightmost digit is also named least significant bit, LSB, while the leftmost digit is named most significant bit, MSB. In computing, a binary digit is named bit and it is the base unit of information. A byte is a unit of digital information in computing that most commonly consists of 8 bits. One byte can store 2 raised by the exponent of 8, hence 256 different binary values, usually representing the numbers 0 to 255. A bit can be implemented in electronic circuits by a two-state device, like a latch. Besides using discrete devices, as demonstrated in one of the previous videos, a latch can also be constructed from a pair of cross-coupled NOR logic gates. Whenever the circuit is connected to the supply voltage, the initial state depends on the electric properties of the logic gates. The output signal at Q can be either high or low. Let's assume the signal is low. The input signals at S and R are also low. Both inputs at the upper NOR gate are low, hence the output signal of the gate is high. The output of the upper gate is connected to one of the inputs of the lower one, hence one of the inputs of this gate is high and so its output signal is low. The state of the whole circuit is stable. Q bar is high, bringing the cross-coupled gate of Q low, which in turn keeps the upper gate of Q bar high. If input S is connected to high level, the state of the circuit changes. The output of the upper gate changes from high to low level, hence by now both inputs of the lower NOR gate are on low level. The output of the lower gate changes to high level by what both inputs of the upper gate are high. The state of the circuit is stable. Q is high while Q bar is low. If input S falls back to low level, the feedback maintains the output state. While both inputs are low, the circuit is in hold state. If R is connected to high while S is held low, Q changes from high to low, forcing the upper gate to change from low to high via the cross-coupled input. During hold state, there is no change of the output state. Input S is called set, bringing output Q to high, while input R is called reset, bringing Q to low. Output Q is the complement of Q bar. Q is not Q bar. If both inputs are high, the combination is called forbidden state or restricted combination. Both outputs Q and Q bar are low, and the logical equation Q is not Q bar is broken. During normal operation of a single storage cell, this state should never occur. The forbidden state is stable too. As long as both inputs are held on high level, both outputs stay on low level. Depending on which input falls back to low level first, Q or Q bar is brought to high level. The circuit is called set reset latch. A short pulse at one of the inputs sets or resets output Q. If output Q is on low level, subsequent pulses at the reset input effect no change of the output state. Same is for the set input while Q is high, and finally a high level at both inputs results in the forbidden state, with low level at both outputs. In computing, latches are usually controlled by electronic signals rather than by mechanical switches. A latch can also be composed of a pair of cross-coupled NAND gates. At the circuit shown here, output Q of the NAND circuit to the right is at the top, while it is placed at the bottom of the NOR latch. When using two cross-coupled NAND logic gates, set and reset become active low signals, denoted S bar respectively R bar. If there is a low signal at input S while R is held high, output Q is set to high level. Q is reset if input R is low while S is held high. The hold state requires high level at both inputs, and the forbidden state results while there is a low level at both inputs, bringing both output terminals to logical high. By inserting additional logic gates to the inputs of the NOR as R latch, the resulting circuit is a gated latch. If input C, meaning control or clock, is low, the output of both AND gates is also low, hence the input of the SR latch is in hold state. If C switches to high, the gate becomes transparent and the state of input D, meaning data, propagates directly through the circuit to output Q. The output is reset whenever input D is low, and it is set if D is high. The C input is sometimes denoted by an E, meaning enable. As you can see, the state of output Q doesn't change as long as there is a low signal at the clock input. Only while the clock signal is high, the state of input D propagates to output Q. The configuration of the gated D latch prevents the application of the restricted input combination. Two additional NAND gates are required to turn the NAND SR latch into a gated version. The input NAND stage inverts the data input signal, hence the low state of the control signal produces the hold state at the input of the SR latch, hence there is a high signal at both inputs. Caused by signal transmit time, the restricted combination, meaning low signal at both inputs of the SR latch, can be observed for a short span of time at the animated drawing. Furthermore, the output Q equals Q bar, temporarily. Even if this drawing isn't an exact description of the processes inside of a gated latch, you should consider that the propagation delay of the whole circuit is increasing with each logic gate added to the layout. If your computer is operated with too high clock rates, the output of the memory cell will be scrapped. As you can see, the state of the inputs of the SR latch differ from the ideal state for approximately 50 nanoseconds. Nearly the same time passes by until the final state of the outputs is reached. To avoid misinterpretation of the stored data, the read process should not be started while the data signal propagates through the circuit. Three SR NAND latches are required to build a positive edge-triggered D flip-flop. Whenever the control input is low, both inputs of the output latch to the right are high, regardless of the data input, hence the output latch is in hold state, storing the previous state. Depending on the data signal, Q is set or reset when the control signal changes from low to high. Only at this very short time interval the data signal has to be stable, so that the signal can reliably propagate to the output of the flip-flop. Even if the control input stays high, the output Q keeps its state regardless of the data input. The positive edge-triggered D flip-flop captures the value of the data input at the rising edge of the control signal. There is no change of the output signals at the falling edge of the signal. The circuit composed of 6 integrated NAND logic gates shown here is defective. As you can see, the state of output Q is kept while the clock signal is low. Q is set if the data input is on high level and the clock signal changes from low to high, and that state of the gate is kept even if the data signal changes again. While the clock signal falls back to low, Q is reset, which should not happen. When having a look at the oscilloscope plot of the upper input of the right latch, you can observe multiple pulses while the clamp of the clock input was released. The reason is the so-called contact bounce, which has to be considered whenever mechanical switches are actuated. Furthermore, the feedback between the 6 NAND logic gates may cause high frequency signals at the inputs of the right latch. The unwanted high frequency signals can be blocked by a low pass filter, composed of a resistor and a capacitor at both inputs of the right latch. Now, the positive edge-triggered flip-flop changes the state of output Q indeed only at the rising edge of the clock signal. Caused by the low-pass filter, the propagation delay of the circuit is increasing clearly. Approximately 0.9 milliseconds are passing by until output Q has reached its new state. Latches are available as integrated circuits, usually with multiple latches per chip. Two positive edge-triggered flip-flops are placed at the device used here. Just one of them is used at the demonstration circuit. The inputs are controlled by electronic pulses. The propagation delay is clearly lower than that of the previous circuit. To be able to store more than just a single bit, several flip-flops have to be grouped. If the flip-flops are arranged in a chain, sharing the same clock and with the output of one flip-flop connected to the data input of the next one, the circuit is called shift register. All bits of the chain shift by one position at the rising edge of the clock signal. During write operation, each data bit of 1 byte is presented at the D input connected to the first flip-flop and all bits are shifted right each time the clock signal is rising. With each positive going signal at the clock input, the state of the flip-flop's D input, which correlates to the output state of the previous flip-flop to the left, propagates to its output and after 8 cycles, 1 byte is stored in an 8-bit register. The byte can be read after the write operation is finished in parallel mode at the outputs Q1 to Q8. The binary number 10011101, representing the decimal value 157, is written into the shift register. It has to be ensured that the read operation is not triggered during write operation, or else you will get scrapped data. To avoid change of the parallel outputs during write operation, a latched output can be added to the circuit. Some later we will see how this can be implemented. The circuit operates in serial in, parallel out mode. While the register is clocked, the stored data can also be read at the output Q8 of the far right flip-flop, which is called serial in, serial out mode. With each cycle, the bit at that flip-flop is shifted out and lost, while a logical 0 is stored at the far left flip-flop, hence it is a destructive readout. The wiring scheme of a multiple-purpose 3-bit register is more complex. The register can be operated in several modes. With the load input disabled, meaning on low level, the register operates in serial mode, writing data at the DI input into the memory cells and shifting the data with each rising edge of the clock signal to the DO output. A single pulse at the enable input copies the state of the shift register into the output latches and so to the output pins Q1 to Q3. The latches at the output terminals prevent the register from displaying wrong outputs during the write operation and the circuit operates in serial in, parallel out mode. The data can be read out in serial mode if 3 more pulses are applied to the clock input. Remember that this is the destructive mode, deleting the data of the register. While the load input is enabled, the state of the inputs D1 to D3 is copied into the shift register as soon as the clock signal is rising. A single pulse of the clock signal is sufficient for the load process. If the data is read in serial mode afterwards, the register operates in parallel in, serial out mode. A single pulse at the reset line clears the memory, hence all bits are set to 0, which is faster than loading 000 data in serial mode. Additional flip-flops can be connected to the DO pin to get a larger amount of memory, for example a total of 8 flip-flops results in 1 byte of storage. Here you can see an 8-bit shift register with output latches on a single chip. While data is written into the register via the serial input, the state of the outputs Q1 to Q8 is kept. A short high signal at the storage register clock input triggers the write operation from the shift register to the output latches. The outputs can be disabled by a high signal at the output enable pin, by what Q1 to Q8 switch to low level without deleting the data stored in the output latches. As soon as this input falls back to low signal, the stored data is presented at the output pins again. A low signal at the clear pin deletes the data of the shift register. The output latches are not cleared until a high signal at the storage register clock pin is detected. When driving the storage register clock with a short pulse after each rising edge of the clock signal, we can observe the write operation of the shift register. The data can also be read in destructive mode at the output pin Q8. A data selector, also called multiplexer or short MUX, is a device that selects one of several input signals and forwards the selected input into a single line. If the select input is disabled, the state of input A is forwarded to the output terminal, while the output signal equals input B whenever there is a high signal at the select input. A demultiplexer or short DMUX takes a single input signal and selects one of many output lines. At the circuit drawn here, the input signal is forwarded to output A whenever the select signal is low. Output B equals the input signal if the select signal is high. The disabled output is kept at low level. With the multiplexer, one out of several inputs can be sent to a single data line, while the demultiplexer can be used to forward the data to one of several outputs. Four data channels running through a single line are available when using a 2-in-1 multiplexer and a 1-in-2 demultiplexer. The JK flip-flop is similar to the SR latch treated before. If the J input is high while the K input is low, output Q jumps to high level. If the J input is low while the K input is high, output Q is killed. There is no change in output while both inputs are low. If both inputs are brought high, the output toggles, hence it changes to the logical complement of the current state. An edge-triggered flip-flop with an additional clock input is required to implement the toggle functionality, because it's impossible to bring J and K simultaneously high. The kill signal is set while the clock input is low. If the clock signal changes to high, the state of the outputs is kept. Not before the clock signal falls back to low level, output Q is reset. The input signals are forwarded to the outputs as soon as the clock signal changes back from high to low. At the animation, output Q is set, caused by a high level at the jump input. If input J and K are enabled, output Q changes its state with each falling edge of the clock signal. Caused by the edge-triggered working principle of the circuit, there is no forbidden state of the output signals considering all possible input combinations. Here you can observe the logic functionality of a real circuit. Once again, there are two capacitors used to form low-pass filters at the inputs of the rightmost latch to block the noise caused by the mechanical switches. The flip-flop alters its state only at the falling edge of the clock signal. While the clock signal is low or high, the signal at input J, respectively K, is not affecting the state of the output signal. If J and K are enabled, Q and Q bar are changing their state with each falling edge of the clock signal. Here you can see a JK flip-flop using an integrated circuit. The inputs J and K are joined by what the resulting circuit is a T flip-flop. T means toggle. If the T input is low, the flip-flop holds the previous value, while it toggles whenever the clock input is strobed and the input is high. The toggle flip-flop divides the clock frequency by 2. Arranging several negative edge-triggered T flip-flops in a chain with the Q output of one flip-flop connected to the clock input of the next device results in a binary counter. The input signal is connected to the clock input of the flip-flop at the far left and all T inputs are connected to high signal. With each falling edge of the input signal, the binary number is increased by 1. Even though the drawing implements that all flip-flops are switched simultaneously with the falling edge of the input signal, there is a small propagation delay caused by each device in the chain. The transitions of the flip-flops are asynchronous, hence the circuit is an asynchronous counter. Note that the lowest bit of the binary number is stored in the far left flip-flop. The propagation delay of each flip-flop is added up in the chain of an asynchronous counter while the clock signal crosses the circuit to output Q5. The animation shows the transition from 01111, which is decimal 15, to 10000, which is decimal 16. The output bits ripple in sequence from the left to the right, which is why the circuit is also named ripple counter. In the time period that the ripple takes place, the false outputs 01110, which is decimal 14, 01100, decimal 12, 01000, decimal 8, and 5 times 0, which is decimal 0, are generated. Keep in mind that the least significant bit at the drawing is on the left and the most significant bit on the right, while binary numbers are usually noted with the LSB on the right. The real circuit shown here is mirror inverted compared with the drawing. The least significant bit and so the clock input are at the right of the circuit, which is why the binary number is displayed correctly. The pulses of a mechanical switch connected to the clock input via a low pass filter are counted up. Since the ripple happens very quickly, you are not able to observe the switching sequence from the right to the left and so the effect is tolerable for many applications. Only the oscilloscope plot shows the delay caused by each flip-flop. The ripple takes place at the falling edge of the clock signal, hence a simple solution to avoid reading wrong outputs is to trigger the read process at the rising edge of the clock signal. To create a synchronous counter, the external clock signal has to be connected to the clock input of every flip-flop within the counter. Hence all flip-flops will toggle simultaneously with the rising edge of the external signal. By inserting AND gates, each flip-flop can be enabled to toggle whether or not the outputs of all preceding flip-flops are on high level. At the drawing, flip-flop number 1 on the far left toggles with each rising edge of the external clock signal, while number 2 toggles only if number 1 is logic high. Number 3 toggles if flip-flop 1 and flip-flop 2 are logic high, which is ensured by the AND gate on the far left, and so on. Finally, flip-flop number 5 on the far right, representing the most significant bit, toggles only if the 4 preceding flip-flops are logic high, which is ensured by all 3 AND gates inside of the circuit. Once again, the animation shows the transition from decimal 15 to decimal 16. The outputs of all 5 flip-flops change simultaneously, hence the total propagation delay of the counter circuits equals that of a single flip-flop and there is no ripple effect. The propagation delays of the AND gates don't affect the propagation delay of the counter's output signals, but the maximal frequency of the external clock signal. The next cycle should not start before all gates have reached their final state according to the output of all flip-flops. Counters are also available as integrated circuits. Here you can see a 4-bit up-down counter. Pulses at the left input are added up, while pulses at the middle input are subtracted from the current output value. A single pulse at the right input clears the output value. If the output value reaches the maximum value, 15, the red LED on the left is turned off. With the next rising edge of the count up input, the counting starts over at 0 and the red LED is lighted up again. The count up input of another module can be connected to the red LED to get an 8-bit counter. Adding two values, usually binary numbers, is a very common operation done by computers. When adding two binary digits, there are 4 possible results. The operation can be implemented by using an AND gate, respectively an XOR gate. Two binary digits, A and B, are added up and the result is displayed at the outputs SUM and CARRY. The carry signal represents an overflow into the next digit. The decimal value of the sum is 2 raised by the exponent of 1 multiplied with C plus 2 raised by the exponent of 0 multiplied with S. The storage of a computer is always limited. A 1-bit register can store 2 raised by the exponent of 1, which is 2, an 8-bit register 2 raised by the exponent of 8, which is 256 different binary values. If a calculation produces a result that is greater in magnitude than that which a given register can represent, the overflow condition occurs. The result of case number 4 is a 2-bit number, while both summands are 1-bit numbers. Addition can be done by writing one number below the other and then add one column at a time, starting with the rightmost column. If the result of the partial addition produces an overflow, meaning the result is a 2-digit number, the higher digit is carried to the next column. This method works not only for decimal, but also for binary numbers. When adding two binary numbers following the carry method, up to 3 single bit numbers have to be added at a time. The possible results are listed in the table. An electronic circuit reproducing the addition of up to 3 1-bit numbers is called full adder. When adding two binary numbers, the full adder can carry in the overflow of the next less significant stage and carry out the overflow to the next full adder representing the next more significant stage. Two multi-bit numbers can be added by using multiple full adders arranged in a chain, with the carry in connected to the carry out of the next less significant stage. A half adder, which is an adder without carry in, can be used at the least significant stage. Caused by the propagation delay, the carry out signal is delayed, Hence, there is a ripple effect similar to that of an asynchronous counter, which is why the circuit is called ripple carry adder. While the ripple takes place, the false outputs 266 and 320 are generated when adding the decimal values 175 and 165. Note that the carry out bit at the most significant stage is set after the addition procedure has finished, indicating that the result, 340, is too large to be stored in an 8-bit register. While the overflow condition might occur when adding two binary numbers, the result of a subtraction may drop below zero. In computing, different data types represent different numbers. An unsigned 8-bit integer can hold values from 0 to 255 inclusively, while a signed 8-bit integer can represent a number between -128 and +127 inclusively. For this sign representation method, the leftmost bit denotes whether the value is positive or negative. The value is negative if the leftmost bit is 1, because the value of this bit is subtracted from the sum of all other bits when converting a binary into a decimal number. Considering the numerical representation of signed binary numbers shown here, which is called 2's complement, the decimal number +127 becomes the 8-digit binary number 07×1. Inverting all digits and adding 1 results in -127 in decimal system. Remember that the leftmost digit represents the sign of the value, which is 1, hence it's a negative value. In general, each subtraction can be turned into an addition by using the method shown here. The subtraction of 17-97 can be turned into the addition 17+-97, requiring 8-bit binary numbers. The binary number 011000001 represents +97 in decimal system. Inverting all digits and adding 1 results in -97 in decimal system. The result of the subsequent addition is 10110000 in binary system, which complies to -80 in decimal system, following the rules of the 2's complement. The ripple carry adder can be turned into a ripple carry subtractor by inserting XOR gates at the B inputs and using a full adder at the least significant stage. Another XOR gate is connected to the carry out of the most significant stage, which is the leftmost full adder. Input M controls the operating mode of the circuit. If M is low, the carry in of the rightmost full adder is also low and the circuit operates in adder mode, like explained before. The result of 17+97 is of course 114. If M is high, the carry in signal of the rightmost full adder is also high, which adds 1 to the result. One input of each XOR gate is brought high, hence the bits of register B become inverted at the outputs of the XOR gates. The circuit operates in subtractor mode. After the wrong intermediary results, -114, -84, -88 and -96, which are caused by the ripple, we get the final result -80 in decimal system. Here you can see two microchips, each with a 4-bit full adder. The binary numbers being added up by the circuits are coded by wirings at the breadboard. The result is displayed by the line of red LEDs after a not noticeable delay. In a computer, the inputs of the adder are driven by registers, by what the process of adding two values is clearly faster than I can do the wiring. The upper line with the green LEDs represents the data of register A, the lower one with the yellow LEDs represents register B. As expected, the result of 175 plus 165 is 340. The carry out bit of the second full adder is enabled, because the result doesn't fit in an 8-bit register. The circuits treated in this video and some more are integral parts of the tiny computer shown here. The ATmega device has, amongst other stuff, 32 working registers, 1 KB of RAM, 3 counters and 1 adder. As usual, the interface displaying the results is larger than the computer itself. The calculations are done with 8-bit numbers. Using the wrong type of number for mathematical operation is a very common source of error when writing computer software. 63 minus 71 results in 248 when using unsigned integer values. Signed values have to be defined to get the expected result minus 8. Counting is no problem to the microcontroller and even transforming binary values into decimal numbers can be done. Once more, the 8-bit architecture can be observed. When adding up 1 to the value of 255, the counting starts over at 0. When using several registers for hours, minutes and seconds, the 68,400 seconds of a single day can be counted and displayed as time. That's all about computer circuits for now. There is some more information on the project page. Thanks for watching and I'll be back.